Hello everybody. So my name is Yves-Marie Morgan. I work at Parrot as a software architect at Parrot Drone. And I will present you two components that we developed and put on GitHub, and we developed for the drone, which is based on shared memory and telemetry. So here is the plan of my presentation. So I will first present a use case that we found on drones. Some solution we found and developed. Then the two parts of the solution. So the shared memory libraries called libshdata. A more high-level libraries for the telemetry, and at the end I will present some advanced use cases that were not part of the initial development, but that we managed to develop as well. So let's begin with something we had. So to separate features on a drone, we say okay, we want to have separate processes. Basically, one with responsible for the flight stack, so which make we read sensors and control motors and add a control loop, and another one to handle a vision algorithm, so taking for example a vertical camera and try to detect the speed of the drones based on the move of the drone. So what those two algorithms need to exchange data. The vision algorithm needs some data associated with precisely with the frame acquisition. Basically, it needs to know the orientation of the drones to know if it's flat or not. And also the computing of the output result of the vision algorithm need to be sent back to the flight stack so it can use the vertical spin to enhance, for example, the hovering state. And also we want all those two processes to have a lot of debugging data, so for telemetry, so we can basically, it's like this. So we have three processes. One is the autopilot. So for example, running at a loop at 200 Hz. So it means every 5 milliseconds, it needs to get some input, compute with some algorithm, and then control the motors. So on Linux, having something running at 200 Hz, so and be precisely every 5 milliseconds is already a challenge. It's not part of this, but having it running almost real time on Linux is quite a challenge. So exchanging data with some other computing algorithm, like a vision algorithm that takes camera input, so, and not having the two deadlock or that kind of things is kind of tricky. And at the bottom, so for example, the vision algorithm can run at 60 Hz. So every 12 milliseconds, it has to take a frame, compute some data, and export them. And at the end, we have something called the logger, which takes everything from the two processes and can then log them either on the master edge or send them live to a ground station. So those three processes need to run separately, and they have typically several priorities. The autopilot having the highest priority, vision after, and logger after. So having everything exchanging data was quite of challenging for us. So what we come up as a solution. So for example, we could use regular inter-process communication via sockets or pipes. So we didn't go with this solution because it requires many system calls with the Linux. We need a client server. If we have multiple clients, like in this solution, we can change the scheduling of the system, basically of the autopilot, if it needs to write two things at the same time. We wanted also to make sure that the autopilot has no interference with the other processes, so limit the exchange and everything. So that way, if we do the scheduling and of each thread and if on everything on this process, making sure that adding the logging does not interfere. So we say okay, we will use some kind of shared memory, which is simple. Okay, we have some memory that we exchange between processes, which is okay. So it seems fairly easy, but having to share memory between processes, we need to find some kind of concurrent data structure, FIFO, queue, list. And normally, what we need to do is protect this shared memory with some kind of locking mechanism, for example, mutex or futex. The problem between processes is that if you try to put mutex, you start to have some problem with the latency of the locking and put on also some priority inversions, which can completely change the scheduling of all the processes. And also, there is a problem of if you put a mutex in the shared memory, a process lock it and crash, the mutex is still locked unless you put some flag. So there is a robust flag. So that's also the kind of thing that need to be taken into consideration. So if we want to avoid this locking, we say, okay, we remove the lock and we go to a lock-free system. Again, a lock-free concurrent data structure is not easy to implement. So we say, okay, if we want to go in this direction, we need to make sure that the basic functionalities of having a data structure shared between multiple processes is safe. So we say, okay, we separate in two components. So the library for the shared memory and the locking, the lock-free and the concurrent access. And another one responsible for the high-level API for the telemetry. So the core library called lib shared data. So what it does, it handles a lock-free circular buffer. So I will, on the next slide, see what kind of data structure is in it. Using only some basic atomic operation on the integers. So load, store, and add. What is the circular buffer is simply an array of samples. So it's you can see it as a matrix with some lines, and on each line you have the library takes an opaque sequence of bytes. So at this level it doesn't know exactly what is the byte. It's a library on top of it which will describe what is inside the sample. For each sample, we associate a timestamp. So, for example, at each step of the processing loop, we will have some data. For example, for the autopilot, the angle of the drones, we will associate a timestamp with it and put it in this shared memory. And on the other side, for example, for the vision algorithm, it will take a frame from the camera, have it an acquisition timestamp, and it will search in this circular buffer the sample which is associated with this timestamp, or possibly some sample and potentially some sample before and after. So as a producer, we simply put regularly with time stamp samples, and as a consumer, we say, okay, I want some data at this time stamp. What was, for example, the position of the drone at this time stamp? Or for the logging, it says, okay, give me all the latest samples since the last time I make a query and give them to me. And also, so the circular buffer, of course, will run and override the oldest data, but we can choose the number of samples to decide. Okay, for example, if I put a sample every 5 milliseconds, if I say I have 200 samples, I will have one second of buffering in this shared memory. So this library takes care of everything required to have a lock-free mechanism. So based on some retry, some sequence number that are incremented. So I won't go into detail on how it works internally, but the library is written with also some test case, and internally at each step of the writing, for before writing, after writing, before incrementing some data, we put some hooks so that in the testing case we can change the scheduling by putting some sleep or forcing some rescheduling of some task to make sure that if a write is interrupted in one process, the one process that reads still sees something coherent. So that's the tricky part in having something lock-free. So when we put mutex, okay, we can simply read the code and say, okay, I put my lock here, and it will work. Without mutex, it becomes difficult to simply be sure that the code is correct. So we rely extensively on the test case. So this is how the one section of the shared memory looks like. So for each process that wants to produce some data, we have one shared memory that we call a section. So we find a header inside that describes the shared memory, principally the number of samples, the size of the sample, plus some other variables that allow us to make sure that two concurrent processes does not try to write data on the same section at the same time. Otherwise, it could go bad. We have a part for metadata, which is not directly used by the core library, but only for the telemetry. That in this part, that the producer will say, okay, in this sample, I have, I don't know, three doubles for the triangle, and so on. So we can have 100 different variables for each sample. So each sample have the same thing. So you can see it as a simple data structure that is repeated. We also have for each sample one time stamp and a sequence number that allow us to see when some data are overwritten. For example, let's say that as a reader, I want to read the sample 2. Before reading, we read the sequence number. Then we read the data. Once we read the data from the shared memory, we look back again at the sequence number. If it did not change, it means that the sample was not overwritten. And if it changed, we know that something was changed in the data. So we say, OK, I cannot use this sample. I have to use only the one after. So that's basically the mechanism used for detecting overwrite of the circular buffer. So that was the low level part. So basically, simply I get a sequence of bytes, a data structure. I put it in a slot of the timestamp. And as a consumer, I say, okay, I have a timestamp, I search in the list, and I extract one sample. And so on top of that, we put something called telemetry. So that is a higher level API. What it does is for each sample, it puts a description of what is a sample. Basically, it's a list of names plus type of variables. This API can be used with a C++ API, which using some templates can automatically infer the type, so it can be easier than simply in C, where you need to give the variable its type. So it's better it's easier with a C++ API. Producer and consumer do not directly share a raw C data structure. So which could be a solution, saying, okay, I put a simple header in common between producer and consumer. As a producer, I take my structure, I write it, and a consumer, I read it. You need to make sure that both use the same structure. And if you change it in one side, you have to be careful. So instead, we rely on not sharing anything except the producer write in the metadata header all the names and the type, and the consumer say, okay, I want this variable name, it will have the type, and at runtime, the telemetry library will check that the names are found and that the type is valid. So this way, the consumer can and the producer can be completely separated and not share anything except simply the name and the type of the variable. The telemetry library propose also some logging tools. So basically, it's a simple daemon. So we propose today the two simple plugins. One we call black box, so for a drone. What it does is it takes every sample of all the shared memory in the system. It dumps them in the file. And then compress, and also they are compressed on the fly. So with this kind of file on the system, you can have anything logged without with no interference on the process that produces them, because the process which is the producer simply writes in some memory without any lock, so it is not impacted with the scheduling of the logger, and at the same time, the logging can log whatever it wants in the system. And we also have the possibility to send live the data via TCP or UDP to a ground station, for example. And for those tools also. Because having a binary file is not easy to use. There is several scripts in Python to extract them to some more common files, for example, a CSV file, that later can be post-processed in some tool or to have some other, to be used in some tools to display some nice graph of the evolution of some data in time. I will first. I didn't put the slide in the correct. I don't know if everybody sees. So this is an example of code in C++ of what a producer looks like. So first, the producer declares some small data structure with three values in it. So theta, phi, and psi, the triangles of a drone, for example. Then it creates a producer. So it says the name of the section, for example, angles. Then it says, okay, I want to be able to store 200 samples. then it says the approximative rate in microseconds of the channel noise. So in this case, it's completely wrong. It's not. It was 200 hertz, so it would be 5,000 microseconds. Okay. Then it registers the variables, so theta, phi, epsi, giving it a name. So this here, we are using the C++ API, which is capable of detecting the types of the three variables that are given. So in the C API, which is also available, it's a little bit more complicated because you need to say, okay, theta is double, and I have only one of them of it. So it's a little bit longer to register variables. So and then when it's done, you call read complete. So in this example, the theta phi epsi are in the order of the structure are part of the same structure, but they could be from data from anywhere in the system. The only thing that matters is that internally it stores a pointer to the variable. So it needs to stay around as long as the producer is still valid. And then we have a small processing loop that run again. It should be 5,000 for the rate, and change the variable. So here it's some just an example of modifying the value. Once the value are computed, it says sample, okay, put sample. As a parameter, you normally put the timestamp of the variable, or if you put null, it will take the current timestamp of the system. And what will the put sample do? It will take, as we store the pointer to the three variables, we'll take them and put them in one slot of the shared memory. And this will run until we decide to stop it. And as a consumer, it's basically the same thing. You somewhere declare the three variables you want to retrieve. You create a consumer. You register the variable. You give, this time, the name of the section and the variable, because one consumer can take variable from multiple sections at the same time. So for example, if for the logging, we will take OK for the angle and the vision. Again, you register, you run at some given rate, and then you say, okay, or in this example, it says, okay, I only want the latest sample from the shared memory. But you can also say, okay, I want the closest sample from the timestamp I give, or the oldest sample, or the sample before the timestamp you give, or the sample after the sample, the timestamp given. And also, not with the C++ API, but with the C API, you can also retrieve multiple values around some sample. And once you get them, in this case, we print them, but you can do anything you want. So that's basically how it works. And on this two codes, the only thing which is done, the code doesn't share anything. So no data structure, so it can run completely separately, only the name. So for example, if the consumer says, I want the angle, a variable that does not exist, it will simply say, okay, there will be a log saying, okay, I didn't find this variable. Or if the type is not, for example, if I put a float instead of a double, at runtime, the library will detect that the types do not match, and you will have a warning saying, okay, I found the variable, but the type does not match. Instead of taking a variable with the wrong type and having some wrong effect. But basically, that's all it uses. So it's quite simple. So basically, it's quite used in our product because now we use them to exchange data for even between threads to avoid mutex and that kind of thing. We simply say, okay, I want to share data. I put them somewhere, and on the other side, I get them. And the core library makes sure that when I get a sample, I'm sure that all the samples are from this timestamp and all are coherent. So that was basically the tricky part. Yes? No, the release is just after the running loop is just to close the shared memory also.
So how is it guaranteed that the producer isn't going to overwrite the sample?
For example, what will do the consumer? It will. There is an index in the header that say, okay, the last sample written was in this position. For example, it was the row number 10. So that the writer, the producer, say, okay, in the header I put 10, it's here. The consumer will read the header, it say, okay, the last sample is 10. Then it goes to the row number 10, reads the timestamp, the sequence number, and the sample values. Once it reads them, it reads again the sequence number and the index. If any of them has changed, it means that the sample has been changed. So that's how it works. And basically, that's how many of the log-free mechanism works, is reading something, for example, with an atomic read, read some other data, and then read again the atomic value, and if it's the same, and the producer has written in the correct order also, with that we can make sure that all the information are valid and have not been changed, or you have partial, for example, half of the sample valid and this kind of thing, and also we know that the timestamp is valid and the sequence number is the correct one. So that's how it works. Yes, and depending on the search method, yes, it's returned with okay, I did not find it, or with if it's the latest, okay, we simply internally retry until we have some kind of stabilization in the reading. So if the retry, so depending on the rate of the producer, that's where it begins to become tricky. So for example, with 200 Hz, we didn't see too many issues, but if it's, for example, 1 kHz, 2 kHz, or 4 kHz, so if each millisecond there is a new change, the consumer, if it's a very low priority, we can have some troubles having some kind of stabilization. So it's only the goal is to make sure, okay, at which time we say, okay, I stop looping and return to the caller. And that's also why, for example, the current code that is on the GitHub had some issue with that kind of retry, because the retry was done in the telemetry libraries at the high level, and a new version we put it at the low level to have less problem like that, to be able to have higher frequency for the producer. So, and once we had this running on a Linux, so with all processes running on a single Linux, so we were using the basic shared memory API to open the shared memory and using some log. We had some interesting advanced use case. So if you take some multi-core system on chips, now you can have them with, for example, for multi-cores, but also you can find some big cores plus some additional Cortex-M7 or Cortex-M0 for example, power management or that kind of thing. And so you can, when one of them is running Linux and some of them, some real-time operating system. So if and normally in this kind of system, there is already some kind of memory sharing, so they need to share the DDR, for example.
And if there is some also some cache coherency between all the cores, we decided, what if we use the same libraries to share memory between the Linux and the real-time OS? So we modified the library. So instead of having simply, for the low level, simply opening /dev shm something to, and map it in memory to open, we have another backend, which is opening directly /dev mem and map a specific address. So that's on the Linux side. And on the real-time OS, in general, it's simply a flat memory. So we simply allocate a pointer to a specific address and use it. And each of the libraries is simply having the same view of the RAM and using the atomic operation, we can have the same effect. Of course, it needs to make sure that at the CPU level, the memory is still coherent between all the cores, which is not always the case, but if it's the case, we can use the same basic mechanism. The only thing that needs to be done is to ask, at least at the opening of the libraries, a small negotiation saying, okay, at which address, physical or virtual, is the data. So that on the same time, the Linux and the real-time OS can map the same range of physical memory to their own virtual space. So again, there is a small part that is overridable in the libraries to do that we call a lookup. So for example, it says, okay, for this section, okay, when I create it, will be at this address, and when I open it, it will be at this address. So what it does is, so if you compare the use case compared to the first one I gave you, for example, you can say, okay, in the world, instead of having the fly stack or the autopilot running on Linux, I put it on a real-time operating system. So the shared memory will be on a buffer that points to some shared RAM. So for example, we will still have the angles for the attitude, the speed quality from the vision, and the debug of the autopilot. So basically, everything that needs to be shared between the two operating systems needs to be in a region of the memory that is accessible from the two OS. And on the Linux side, as for example, the section, the debug information for the vision algorithm does not need to be shared, it can stay on the standard shared memory on Linux. And as you can see, so the processes on the Linux side have two ways to access the shared memory, either using /dev shm for the standard shared memory, or opening /dev mem and mapping the portion of the RAM that is given by the below to the inter-process communication. So the inter-process communication is not, we will rely on normally, in general, something specific to the system on chip or on the Linux or the real-time operating system. So the library does not provide some generic communication, but if in general it's just one message that needs to be exchanged between the two OS, and normally if on the system you have already two operating systems, in general there is already something existing that can be reused. Simply need to implement the open and the create to exchange the address of the memory. So that was that. And the two components are already available on GitHub. So I put here the two components. The two components here are quite old, but were used when we put them when we put some for one of our drones, we I don't remember which kind of open source autopilot we used. Ardupilot, where we had the vision algorithm with, that was on a separate processes from the fly stack, so that at this time we put them and to have it working between the fly stack, that it was basically for licensing reasons that we put two separate processes. And if I have time, I will try to put the updated version, which has better performances for the consumer when the frequency of the producer goes up. And I think it's my last slide.
This is why a lot of people did get together and started creating something called OpenAMP, also known as Remote Proc in Linux, where basically people are standardizing on a single framework for remote communication between anything, between different processes, mm-hmm. between different components in your system, based on the Verdeo protocol. This gives you pretty much, from what I can tell, very similar benefits as your mm-hmm. shared library thing. Obviously, the libtelemetry would still be above because that abstracts your key store away. But the shared memory communication, it might be a good idea to take a look at if you haven't, or maybe you did. That's the question. Did you take a look at Remote Proc and OpenAMP before to see if that might be?
I don't remember.
So that in that case, you probably want to take a look because that might solve a few issues that could come up going forward. Because one of the things I did realize seeing your slides is that, especially when you're talking about different component communication, if you're going via DevMem, from what I can see from current upstream discussions, at least in the ARM64 tree, people are trying to get rid of DevMem altogether. So it will not be a viable alternative to share memory between outside components and your component. By just poking different memory physical addresses in your address space. I'm not even sure if it works today still.
Yes, but basically, yes, the use of the slash devmem was more of an opportunity for us to make to go quickly, but yes, and also we wanted something, let's say, not too complicated, so we can search for bugs that can unsing. And what is the name exactly?
So the project that basically tries to consolidate all of those efforts is called OpenAMP.
Okay. Thanks.
Sure.
I just wondered, in your data format, why did you need timestamps and sequence numbers? Wouldn't one of them be enough?
The sequence number is here to it was not present actually in the upstream version. It's not, but we put it because as the logging for when we were dumping the data, we wanted to make sure that there was no holds in the dumped data, and basically that was why we put the sequence number, to make sure that all. We were able to dump all the data. Because the timestamp, we had some issue. We didn't want to use the timestamp as as the producer can decide to put it on timestamp. We wanted to make sure that inside the library there was a mechanism to make sure that there was no holes in the data when we were dumping them, because sometimes there were some producers that were not really putting the some timestamp not at a regular rate. So it was hard for us to say, okay, is it the producer that is doing something wrong or the consumer? So we say, okay, we will put this sequence number, so we will have a different proof that in which side we had the issue.
Last question. The samples you've presented, they were polling based. I mean, the reader had a loop. Okay. Do you have some sort of event based API? Because as far as I can see, there is no timing and there is no way for the consumer to know when there is new data incoming.
No, we didn't put it, because in most of our use case, each loop would just do some computing is in general triggered by some external events. For example, for the autopilot, the trigger is the new sample from the hardware for the IMU. And for the vision, in general, it's is triggered by the new frame, and each in both use cases, these triggers have the initial timestamp of the event that occurred, and then we say, okay, there is an event at this timestamp. What are the data at this timestamp? So on, there is something that say, okay, give me the next sample, but it only uses the rate that is given by the producer as a hint of how much time we need to wait. So at one time we say, okay, what will be the changes required to have something based on events, and it required to have some at the producer side some events, and finally we change all the way the consumer were done to avoid that completely.
Thank you.